When I saw this last night, tears just welled up in my eyes. Go to John 21 with it. I want to show you something. Just, it broke my heart, and I hope and pray that it'll touch you. This John 21, go to verse 15, and just wait for us. We're going to start at verse 15. It's very familiar, but I want to show you something. The Holy Spirit, last night, I just had to stop and get my handkerchief and just, oh God, I'd never seen it before. Verse 15, John 21. So when they'd finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? More than the other disciples, he means. He said to him, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. He said to him, tend my lambs. That means in the King James has the correct one, feed my lambs. He said to him again the second time, Simon, son of John, do you love me? He said to him, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. He said to him, shepherd, or feed my sheep. He said to him the third time, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter was grieved because he said to him the third time, do you love me? And he said, Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you. Jesus said to him, feed my sheep. Now look at me. You know what we've thought of? You know how we've dealt with this scripture? He said, go evangelize. Go teach the people. Go preach. It's much more than that. Isn't Jesus Christ the bread, the living bread? Doesn't he feed us? Let me put it this way. There's some of you that I know that come to these meetings and you feed me. And you don't say a word. You've never preached to me. You've never witnessed to me. But you feed me. There's something about your countenance. You've been shut in with God. And there's a love for the Word in you. And you sit and you drink it in. And I see Jesus in you. And seeing that, you feed me. It feeds something in me. It's a hope you give me. It's a joy. That's why Paul the Apostle, when he's writing to the church and they were overcoming, he said, you're my joy in the Lord. You're my life. You're feeding me. You feed something in me. I want to see people loving Jesus, and you feed that in me. I want to see people in the Word, and you feed that in me. That hope, you feed me. There's some of you here, you feed me. Well, I love to be around you. But just being around some of you, feed me. You know what he's saying to Peter? Peter, when you denied me, you already took something out of these men, your brethren. You were a hope. You had such zeal. And when you failed, they were so cold and empty as a result of that. Now, I want you to love me so much that your love for me will be an example. You'll feed them. You'll be feeding their spirits. You know that Peter's been feeding me ever since? When I see Peter stand in front of the same priest who crucified Jesus, the same priest that once made him cower, he's standing before Annas and Caiaphas, he's standing before that same mob who crucified Jesus, and he ran from them. Now he's saying, they're saying, don't you dare preach in the name. He said, who are we to listen to man? I'm listening to God at the risk of his life. That feeds me. Peter's been feeding the world ever since. Oh yeah, I've had God say to me, it's not enough to protect the church of the devil, but to feed the sheep. You can get a shepherd can get a whole flock of sheep in there and be so concerned about the enemy, he doesn't feed them. And they can be the most protected flock and starve them to death. No, it's not just security, it's feeding. Jesus, you said, if you love me, feed my sheep. Feed. Lord, I want to feed my brothers and my sisters. I want to love you more to the extent that you're not just first, but you're everything. That nothing in this world's going to hold me. Not my ministry. Not anything in this world. That I would be shut in with you, growing in the knowledge of your love. And that you so consume my mind and my thoughts that when I'm around people, they'll see Jesus. And their hungry hearts will be fed. Lord, it's not so much what I've said this morning is the Spirit of the Lord that makes it real. Now, Holy Spirit, you gave this now. Bless it. Let it bring forth fruit in our hearts. Let it bring forth fruits. Are you anxious to be one who feeds the sheep? Oh, it's not just the preacher in the pulpit. You're to feed the sheep.
Hello, folks, this is Pastor Mike Hoggard, pastor of Bethel Church in Festus, Missouri, and head of prophetic research ministry with another Watchman video broadcast. We're not going to be talking about any news stories this week, It's been, to be honest with you, it's been kind of a slow news week. I mean, everybody's talking about the Ground Zero Mosque and all the stuff that's related to that, and everybody's talking about the economy and how it's not going very well and everything like that. And I thought, yeah, we've kind of talked about that before, and you know, maybe you know, the sad part is with this broadcast, if the news picks up next week, that's usually a bad thing, you know. And so anyway, we're not going to be dealing with any news stories this week. I'll tell you how I came to this. This has been, of course, a study of mine over the last several years. But it's also been not just the book learning, although we can learn a lot from the book, but it's been a lot of experience as well. See, there's somebody after me. And they are out to get me. You know, it sounds like I'm paranoid, you know. There is somebody out to get me. And it's a woman. And she's not very nice, but she always seems like she's nice. And you'll understand who I'm talking about here just a little bit, because I'm actually going to give her name over the broadcast. But it kind of came about as a result of a pastor calling me this week. And he was telling me some things that was going on in his church. And he described a situation where, and I don't want to give too many of the details, but he described a situation. And there was a spiritual stronghold in this man's church. And I recognized it as he was telling me the story. See, this same woman that is after me was in his church after him. And I'll go ahead and tell you that I'll go ahead and release the woman's name. Her name is Jezebel. I mean, like literally, her name is Jezebel. I'm going to talk about a Jezebel spirit. We know that Jezebel is a prototype in the scriptures, the real Jezebel, 1 Kings chapter 21. We're going to be looking at some things there and other places in the Bible. But she is a type and a picture of mystery, Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. I teach people in seminars on typology and so on, that the typology of a woman in the Bible reveals a church, either or a spirit, either the virtuous church without spot or wrinkle, beautifully adorned bride of Jesus Christ, or the harlot church, a spirit of rebellion. And we'll look at all of those places. We're going to go to a lot of places in Scripture in this broadcast. But this woman had him in this man's church. It was literally a woman and her husband that had embedded themselves in a position of strength inside of this man's church. And he knew for a while that there was trouble being started and being carried about in his church by this particular woman. But he was always, and here it is, he was always afraid because of the position that this woman had in his church. She had a position of influence, a position of strength. And as soon as he told me that, I said she represents a stronghold. She had a stronghold position in this man's church, and he was always afraid to confront the issue or confront her particular or anything like that. And that's generally how it is. You know us men, we like to be tough, and you know we can't. You know, there's no man we'll back down to. Yeah, but there's some women we will. And that is just the case. Now, I don't want anybody who watches this broadcast who has the Spirit of God in them. I don't want anybody of God's people, especially any women, saying, "You're demeaning to women, you're knocking us," and blah, blah, blah. I don't want that. I think my teaching is clear on the role of women. God designates and God designs roles. Now, that's not made up by the Catholic Church, and we're just following that. Those things are designed by God, and we'll look at that in the Scripture today. So I don't want any of God's people being offended, but I will tell you that if you're not one of God's people and you listen to this and you're a woman, you probably will be offended by some of the things that I'm going to say. And I don't want to be offensive, but you're not offended at me. You're offended at the Bible. You're offended at the Word of God. And so we're going to talk about the spiritual stronghold that is Jezebel. Now, I will tell you that Jezebel, that spirit, will operate in either a man or a woman, a male or a female, inside of a church or inside of a marriage, inside of a home in particular. A son or a daughter could have that Jezebel spirit on them. Inside a work environment, that you might recognize some of these characteristics. Inside of our country, I absolutely can see, but you know, on the Capitol Dome of Washington, D.C., we have this nearly 20-foot tall goddess. You know, it's like she's in charge of everything here. And so I believe that spirit is a spirit that is leading the direction of our country. We can see it in our churches. We can see it in just about every realm of life. And I would just want to go verse by verse, scripture by scripture, and I want us to talk about that spirit that is Jezebel. We first look in the scriptures, Proverbs chapter 2, verse 16. The Bible says, to deliver thee from the strange woman, even from the stranger which flattereth with her words. Now, I'm going to stop right here. We're just going to kind of walk slowly through the scriptures and just understand the wisdom that God is trying to give us. And I know that there are some good families out there, some good pastors, some good church people, that really, I mean, you guys are the best of the best. You want God's ways in your life. You want anything that's wrong to be thrown out of your life, and you want anything that's right to be placed in your life. And so this is, I think, why I'm teaching this. Now, I don't know the full extent other than right now just to educate people, help educate pastors about what they can expect inside of their churches. We get this idea that we start pastoring the church and people are getting saved and everything's going to be peaches and cream until the Lord comes. And that's not how it is. This spirit is going to operate in a church. It's operated in this one before, probably will again. And so I just want to educate people on what's going on. I mentioned a while ago this woman being after me. She's not very nice, but she appears to be nice. She says the right things. And so the strange woman, now I want you to get this idea that a harlot woman will say what you want to hear. Now, let's stop right here for a minute. And we may just, I mean, I don't know how long this broadcast is going to last. We're just going to go until God gives us some wisdom here. How many elected politicians, how many politicians who are running for office run on this same spirit? They will tell people what they want to hear in order to get elected. Barack Obama is not the only one who did that. Very few don't. Most people who are trying to get elected will tell you what you want to hear. That spirit that flattereth with words. While they say one thing, I mean, just figure that this woman, I mean, just let's just kind of look at the reality of this. Here's a woman, she's a harlot, she's a prostitute. Here comes some old ugly guy, nasty looking, gross out guy. She's going to tell him what he wants to hear. She's going to do that. And so watch the person in your church or in your family or whatever realm of life it is who goes around telling you what you want to hear all the time. Watch out for that. The Bible says, she forsaketh the guide of her youth and forgetteth the covenant of her God. For her house inclineth unto death, and her paths unto the dead. None that go unto her return again, neither take they hold of the paths of life. Now, just very, very simply to illustrate this, there are two paths. Oh, let's see. There was a Led Zeppelin song called Stairway to Heaven. And part of the words were, yes, there are two paths that you can go by. He was right. There are two paths. There is the path. Let me see. Let's pull out an illustrative book here. Let's pull out Marilyn Ferguson's Aquarian Conspiracy, because she's a woman and she was writing this. This is sort of the New Ager's Bible. And she's writing this under the influence of Mystery Babylon the Great. And here is the Word of God. These represent the two paths that you can go by. And this one is going to lead you to hell, because it says that her house inclineth unto death, and her paths unto the dead. None that go unto her return again, neither take they hold of the paths of life. So she's waiting for you. She's setting a trap, and she's waiting for you, and she's going to lead you to hell. This book, however, will lead you to heaven and to eternal life. This is from God the Father. This is from Mystery Babylon the Great. So this strange woman, who is, and by the way, she's a strange woman because she's not your wife. She is something other than your wife. Now, I want you to understand that. A strange spirit. Here we go. A strange Bible in your church is this strange woman. And since the Bibles have all changed, now the preaching has turned from preaching the old paths to preachers flattering with their words, telling you what you want to hear. And people just love that kind of preaching. But that's who she is. Proverbs chapter 5 verse 3. For the lips of a strange woman drop as an honeycomb, and her mouth is smoother than oil. But her end is bitter as wormwood, sharp as a two-edged sword. Her feet go down to death. Her steps take hold on hell. Lest thou shouldest ponder the path of life, her ways are movable, that thou canst not know them. Now, we have several videos, and some of these verses I've used in a couple videos in the past, and I've kind of updated some of this teaching here, but I'm going to give you an illustration of this here in just a little bit, where it says, her ways are movable, that thou canst not know them. Proverbs chapter 7, verse 1. My son, keep my words and lay up my commandments with thee. Keep my commandments and live, and my law as the apple of thine eye. Bind them upon thy fingers and write them upon the table of thine heart. Say unto wisdom, thou art my sister, and call understanding thy kinswoman, that they may keep thee from the strange woman, from the stranger which flattereth with her words. Now, God right here is writing for us a prescription, an antidote to keep us away from Mystery Babylon or spiritual Jezebel. He's writing for us an antidote, and he's saying, lay up my words. Thy word have I hid in mine heart, that I might not sin against God. And God is telling us that the antidote, or the medicine that saves us from the influence of Mystery Babylon, is the Word of God. That is why this spirit hates the Bible so much. She hates, you guys are to know that when I say Bible, I don't just mean, you know, just any old Bible. I mean this King James Bible right here. This is why, I mean, stop and think about it. Are the churches right now, a majority of the churches, totally Bible-less now? I mean, they have some sort of religious text up on the screen, don't they? It's usually an NIV, a New English Bible, or a New American Standard Bible, or the Message Bible, or any of these other new Bibles that are keep coming out. It's not that they don't have anything that they don't call a Bible. They have something that looks like Bibles, but they will not have a King James Bible anywhere near the place. The Pew Bibles are not King James. The Award Bibles are not King James. The Sunday School Literature is not King James. The music doesn't have King James verses in it. That's why they moved away from the hymns, because they have King James words in them. They can't handle that. This spirit cannot handle the Bible. She cannot handle the Word of God. She will fight you tooth and nail. This is why when you got up this morning and you knew that you should have been reading your Bible, this is why you didn't. She was working at you to keep you away from the wisdom that God has laid up for you, which would keep you from that strange woman and that woman that flattereth with her lips. Now, we mentioned a while ago about the, you know, how Proverbs said her ways are movable, that thou canst not know them. Now, I'm going to illustrate this for you, and I want you to look at this verse in Malachi chapter 3, verse 6. He said, "For I am the Lord, I change not." Now, this we have this image of stone here, and I want you to think about this. Think about what God wrote His Ten Commandments on. Did He write them in clay and say, "Here, look at this"? Did He write them in pencil? Did He write them upon the top of the water and then it's soon gone away? No. He wrote His laws and His commandments upon stone so that we would understand that once God's Word is written, it doesn't change. It never changes and it's never supposed to change. That's how God's Word is. And so here we have this image of the unchangeable, unalterable Word of God. It is in place. It never moves and it never changes. That's God. But notice this verse again. "Lest thou shouldest ponder the path of life, her ways are movable that thou canst not know them." And I've used this illustration before with Play-Doh. I mean, you can take, and I used to love Play-Doh. And I always, and I never got one, always one of those fuzzy pumper barber shops. I don't know if you remember that or not. But I used to love playing with Play-Doh. And of course, I didn't know then that you could eat this stuff. You know, a little sugar on top, probably been pretty good. But anyway, Play-Doh, why, you can make whatever you want. In fact, with Play-Doh, you can use your imagination. You can make up whatever you want to make up, and you can make it however you want to. Now, this is setting a stage here, because Jezebel in a church cannot handle rules. She cannot handle rules. She cannot handle authority of any kind. She cannot handle that. She doesn't like bylaws. She doesn't like a constitution. Think about that for a minute. What spirit is driving the politics of America right now? It is the spirit of Jezebel, because she cannot handle rules. She can't do it. "Her ways are movable that thou canst not know them." Any dictator operates under the spirit of Jezebel, because they just make it up as they go. They don't like somebody, kill them, cut their head off, okay? They don't like what somebody did over here, execute them, get them out of here. Well, where's that in law? I'm the law here. That's mystery bad. So it could be male or inside of a male or a female. But any place where rules are not respected and laws are not respected, that is where a spirit of Jezebel is. She hates anything that can't be moved. And so when people in a family, when mom and dad decides to take us down, don't you listen to this, this is good parenting skills. Mom and dad, no means no. Mom and dad, put your foot down. Mom and dad, quit backing down so that your kids will be your friend. Stop it. The spirit of Jezebel. I don't blame the kids of America so much today as I blame mom and dad. Mom and dad's job is to stand and not move. But a spirit comes in and the kids know that mom and dad don't even live right half the time, and they're just going to make stuff up. And kids know that they push hard enough, they can get whatever they want and get by with whatever they want. That's Jezebel. Her ways are movable that thou canst not know them. And kids need structure. They need order. They need to know what the rules are, and they need to know their security as a child is going to come from mom and dad who'll say, "No. You're not doing that. No, you can't go over there. No, you can't listen to this." That's God's spirit. The spirit of Jezebel says, "Oh, let's do whatever we want to." Okay? Most companies in this world, most businesses in this world cannot operate on this idea, "Let's do whatever we want to," unless you're DreamWorks Television or DreamWorks Pictures. Okay? You cannot run a business based upon what everybody feels like doing in any given hour of the day. It does not work. That spirit does not work. Inside of a church, Jezebel hates the Bible. She hates Bible preaching. She hates churches that have rules against certain things or against how you dress when you come in. Jezebel cannot handle that, especially rules of dress, and we're going to see that here in a little bit. She cannot handle these things and these issues. She likes for all the rules to be done with. She's the one that says, rules are made to be broken. That's what she says. If you've encountered that at the workplace, if you've encountered that in your church, if you've encountered that in your home, in your family, if you see that in this country, then you know exactly what spirit that is that's operating. She always says, let's see what this will do. Let's use our imagination. Let's use our intuition. Let's go by what our feelings are. And you watch this, some of this Sunday school material. Some of the small group Bible study, you know, they'll bring up some concept out of the Bible, you know, without quoting the Bible, because you don't want to offend anybody by quoting the Bible. They'll bring up some concept out of the Bible and they'll ask people, how do you feel about that? I mean, how would you feel? How would you feel if you were Goliath and David came and hit you on the head with a big old stone and cut your head off? How would that make you feel? This is how you can detect what's going on inside of the Bible study groups, inside of the church, inside of the home, based upon feelings and emotions, experiences. Churches are marketing themselves with experiential worship toward God. In other words, they're turning churchgoers into drug addicts. Because they bring them into the service. The service is designed by the music, by the lighting, by the atmosphere and everything around it. The worship service is designed to elicit a feeling or an emotion or an experience inside of someone. And that experience is a experience of joy and, oh, I just felt so alive and I felt so free. And that's what keeps them coming back. And it's just like a drug. And they're drugged on that. And so when they come to your church, Pastor, and you're preaching out of this old King James Bible, they say, oh, that's all dry. And I just didn't get anything out of that. I mean, I didn't feel like I felt here at the other church. We go to that church, Pastor, because we like their music. I mean, that makes us feel good. And churches are all about experiences and this connection with God that gives you this little tap in of emotion. And you get hooked on that. Just like you get hooked on any drug, you get hooked on that. The imagination. And Paul said, cast down imaginations. Intuition. A woman who feels, well, I just feel like it should be done this way. Or I just feel like it should be that way. But what does the Bible say? Well, she doesn't like that because in her mind, rules are made to be broken. Now, Jeremiah chapter 9, God warned us about this. In verse 14, the Bible says, but have walked after the imagination of their own heart. And here it is, after Balaam, which their fathers taught them. Now, I'm going to stop right here. The static word of God will lead you to God. Reading this Bible will lead you to God. We don't need the drama teams. We don't need the extra musicians. We don't need the pastor with the cool hair gel wearing his sneakers up on stage looking cool. Rock on. Oh, sorry. I didn't mean to make a hand signal here. We don't need the pastors like that. We need the Word of God to lead us to God. That's what we need. But Mystery Babylon doesn't lead you to God. Although she calls him God, she doesn't lead you to Jesus. Although she might say Jesus, she leads to Baal. And I want you to get this concept. Her job is to take you away from here and take you to here. That's her job. And she does it well. She's not lazy, I can tell you that. She does her job well. But have walked after the imagination of their own heart and after Balaam, which their fathers taught them. Therefore thus saith the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, behold, I will feed them, even this people, with wormwood and give them the water of gall to drink. Now I want you to ponder that for a while. God said he would give them wormwood. I want you to look in Revelation chapter 8 and see wormwood and see that it's one of the trumpet judgments prophesied in the last days. Babylon is going to run her course in this world. Jezebel is going to have her way finally. And it's going to cost her and it's going to cost all of those who follow her their souls. They will be in absolute bitterness. Now, I want to go, and I already have my Bible opened up here, because there's probably some things in the Scripture that I might want to deal with that's not part of my little prefigured, preset slides here. In 1 Kings, we're going to end up in 1 Kings chapter 21. We're going to talk about Jezebel and Naboth and Ahab. But we get an introduction to Jezebel in 1 Kings chapter 16, verse 31. The Bible says, "And it came to pass, as if it had been a light thing for him to walk in the sins of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat," this is talking about Ahab, "that he took to wife Jezebel, the daughter of Ethbaal, king of the Zidonians, and went and served Baal and worshipped him." Did you catch that? Here is Ahab, and he is the king of Israel. He is the king of God's people. Now, number one, he's got a problem in that he followed in the sins of Jeroboam, who you remember was the servant that took the 10 tribes north and cut them off. And see, he didn't want any of the Israelites going down to Jerusalem to worship God anymore. So he had them build two pagan temples up there and put these golden calves in there and said, "Now this is where all my people are going to go to worship." Now, Ahab not only is going to follow in that direction, but Ahab decided, you know what? I don't like these Israelite women. I mean, I just don't like them. So he's looking at the Zidonians, and he spots a woman who's named after her god, Jezebel. That's who she's named after. She's not named El Jez, you know, like, you know, God and this and that. She is named after Baal. And she's the daughter of the king of Zidonians, Ethbaal, who's got Baal's name and his name as well. And so he marries a woman named Jezebel, who's the daughter of a Baal worshiper, the king of Zidonians. And what happens? Ahab, instead of worshiping God, he's worshiping Baal. See how it worked? It didn't take him long, did it? We're going to see how she, in fact, we already get an idea of how this works. Do you think the first time that Ahab ever set eyes on Jezebel, that she was, I mean, she didn't have her hair fixed, didn't have her makeup on, standing there in her robe with a cigarette in her mouth like that? Do you think she looked like that? No way in the world. And do you think the first time Ahab set his eyes on Jezebel, she went, "What are you looking at? You go mind your own business. In fact, I got a toilet in here that needs fixed. Get in there and fix my toilet." Do you think that's... No. No. Probably when Ahab met Jezebel, she probably just laid it on him. Dressed up, fixed her hair, put her paint on. We'll see that in the Bible here in a minute. Put her paint on her face. And just use those flattering words. "Oh, Ahab, you're such a man. Any gal would be so lucky to be with you." She flattered him with her words and her appearance. Stop and think about this, people. Why are you going to the church you're going to? "Oh, I like the music. I like what I hear. I just, you know, this church has more to offer. You know, when I walk in this church, you know, this $6 million building, when I walk in here, I mean, there's a coffee bar over here, and, you know, there's a little bookstore here, and they've got a big gymnasium with workout machines, and we dance aerobics on Friday night, and my kids are going down, and they're on slides in Sunday school. I mean, they like that. And that preacher, he don't dress up, and I don't have to dress up either." Flattery of the eyes is what is drawing people in to a Jezebel church. I want you to think about this, okay? So this is our introduction to her, and it's not looking good already. Now, 1 Kings chapter 18, verse 4, look at her. "For it was so, when Jezebel cut off the prophets of the Lord, that Obadiah took 100 prophets and hid them by 50 in a cave and fed them with bread and water." Now later on we see that what this phrase "cut off" means, she didn't mean like that, you know, cut their noses off or nothing. She had them killed. The prophets of the Lord, She had him killed. I cannot tell you the number of people, and in fact, I don't even like to think about it, the number of people that don't like Mike. They don't like Mike. That spirit of Jezebel cannot handle the preaching of God's word. And she is out there. Any family that will not go to church anywhere, that's Jezebel. Because she can't handle that, okay? People in your church that only come about every other third Sunday, that's Jezebel. That's that spirit, okay? A spirit inside of a church that's constantly going through pastors and trying to... This pastor comes in, takes a stand, she don't like it, that guy's out the door. In fact, I know some of these pastors that when they move from one church to the next, they very seldom ever take most of their stuff out of the boxes. Because there's a pretty good chance in a couple of years, they're going to be picking the boxes up again, headed down the road, going somewhere else. That is a travesty that has turned it, has turned this country upside down. Okay, she hates the King James Bible. She hates the preachers who preach the truth. She hates them. And at some point, she's going to be able to kill them. Oh, not in America. Oh, Pastor Mike. See, we're going to be raptured. Whew. Okay? We'll see. I hope we are. Because, you know, I'd rather be raptured than, you know, have my head cut off. But we'll see. But I'm telling you, she hates guys that preach. She hates them. Okay? 1 Kings chapter 18, verse 19. Now therefore send and gather to me all Israel unto Mount Carmel and the prophets of Baal 450. And I want you to look at this. And the prophets of the groves 400, which eat at Jezebel's table. Now I want you to think about this for a minute. Okay? He's mentioned the prophets of Baal 450. And then he mentioned the prophets of the groves. Now, here's an illustration here of groves. You've seen, I don't know if you've seen this video about the Bohemian Grove, this place out in California that the rich and elite go to. And, I mean, it's a real place, and there's a real deal going on here where they're worshiping this owl idol. And I am getting closer to being able to biblically understand this owl worship and this owl symbolism. And I mean, I'm getting closer to it. I'm not there yet, but I'm getting closer to it from biblically understanding what this is all about. But this is a grove. It's called the Bohemian Grove. Witches, Wicca, meets in a grove. They like to go outside in nature and meet outside with the trees and the little animals and the birds singing them, and they practice their witchcraft. And probably in everybody's town in the world, you'll drive up and down the streets and you'll see these statues of this goddess inside of a grove. Oh, that's the Virgin Mary. And we don't worship her. We venerate her. It's the same thing. Okay, same thing. When you build a statue inside of a grove, that's Mystery Babylon the Great. And the prophets of the groves are the priests. The Roman Catholic priests are the prophets of the groves. But anyway, a preacher or a minister that is operating and being led and told to do by the spirit of Jezebel. I want you to get this. That verse said that the prophets of the groves, 400, which eat at Jezebel's table. You know, I imagine she probably feeds them pretty good. I imagine that they eat high on the hoggard. Okay? I imagine they eat pretty good, which means I think that there's a lot of preachers out there that are serving Jezebel because she takes good care of her people. These are the guys that are getting the big bonuses in the pulpit. These are the guys that are getting the salary, big salary packages. These are the guys that they know for a fact that if they started preaching some things out of the Bible, people's going to quit coming. There goes their salary package, and they'll have to... So they're not going to fear a word. They're going to keep their mouth shut and they're not going to say a word. You know what that is? You know what Jesus called preachers like that? Hirelings. And when the wolf comes and the sheep are in danger, he's gone. because he's just a hireling. He's just doing it for the paycheck. It's all he's doing it for. Jezebel takes pretty good care for a while of her people, of her guys. These guys make pretty good money, and they're taking very, they're probably given any, can you imagine, and I really think this, I really think that there are probably pastors, elected politicians, government officials everywhere in the world that have probably at some point been offered sinfulness, and they fell into it. And the spirit that's driving that said, you know, we'll keep you fed and we'll keep you going and we'll keep you in all these little secret sins that you've got. You just kind of do things our way. I tend to believe, and I don't have any evidence of this, I tend to believe that some of these big junkets that these politicians go on in this country, you know, that are sponsored by some big businesses, I think these politicians go down there and I think that they can get whatever they want and these little private little clubs. And I think these companies know that. And I think that's why we're in the shape that we're in this country. You see, Jezebel likes to keep her guys close to her. She likes to feed them. And she's feeding them well. But what shall it profit if a man shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Now, 1 Kings chapter 19. This is the story of Elijah, when Elijah had had all the prophets slain and he's run off. Jezebel represents vengeance. And Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done and withal how he had slain all the prophets with the sword. Then Jezebel sent a messenger unto Elijah, saying, so let the gods do to me and more also, if I make not thy life as the life of one of them by tomorrow about this time. Now I want you to think about this, okay? And let's use our illustrations here, okay? Let me mark my place here in 1 Kings 21 so I can get back to it real quick. This is God. This is Mystery Babylon, okay? Now I'm going to ask you a question. Have you ever had anything bad done to you? Yeah, Pastor Mike, yeah. Have you ever had anybody say anything about you behind your back? Oh, yeah, man, I've had that. I hate that, okay? You ever have anybody flip you off, you know, when you're driving down the road and they drive by you and give you the finger or curse at you and things like that? Yeah, that makes me mad. Okay, now I want you to get this, okay? Who does vengeance belong to? I'll give you 3 seconds. 1, 2, 3. God said, vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. Okay? Now, if Jezebel would have been a godly woman, when she saw that all of her preachers had been killed, a godly woman would have fell upon her knees before God and said, God, I don't know what to do now. All my preachers are gone. God, you told me not to have vengeance, and I won't. I'm going to let you deal with this, and I'm going to let you have it. God, please take this situation over in Jesus' name. That's God's way. Her way, and I want to tell you something, a spirit of Jezebel will operate wherever there is vengeance or retribution or payback or I'm going to make him suffer. I'm going to make him regret the day he was... That is a spirit of Jezebel. And I want you to listen to this, and you listen to me real good, okay? Because I'm going to get mean here. I'm going to act like you guys are in my church, and I'm going to get real mean for a minute, okay? Those of you, and if you think I have ulterior motives behind this, you just, well, you go tell God on me. Those of you who have quit going to church, okay? Now, I think there's some people out there that really love the Lord and they love the Bible and they love right ways. And when their church failed and their church turned over, they said, you know what, we can't go here anymore. And they really can't find another place to worship. And God bless you for that. But I know also and believe wholeheartedly that there are some people out there, maybe you watching, that just don't go to church, number one, because you're lazy. Number two, because you have a rebellious spirit. And you've decided that no pastor is as smart as you are concerning the Bible. And there's just no way that you can sit under anybody that's not as smart as you are and knows the Bible. No, there's no way that you're going to sit under a pastor who does not believe that there are aliens at Area 51. Okay? I'm just making an illustration here. But you're basically operating in pure rebellion. And you probably decided a long time ago, you were sitting in this church, and I've seen it happen. You were sitting in this church, and I'm talking about the church you were going to, and you didn't like something the pastor said, and so you told your wife or you told your husband, don't write them a check next week. We're not going to pay tithes here. We're not going to do that. We're keeping. Vengeance does not belong to you. You know what you're trying to do? You're trying to get at him. Okay, I've seen it here. I mean, and I understand not wanting to support. I mean, I'm not sending money to Benny Hinn. Okay, I mean, I'm not supporting him. There's no way in the world. Okay, and I understand about not wanting to support a pastor that's preaching out of the NIV or playing rock and roll music or doing wadding up and doing contemplative prayer. And I can understand, I really can't, you know. And I'm not telling you, hey, support these guys. What I am going to tell you is this, and please take this the right way. And I'm going to have to answer to God for everything that I say. And God, forgive me. God, help me. But if you're not part of a local congregation, and you're not tithing and supporting, and I don't care if it's a mission work somewhere, you're not tithing, you're in rebellion. You're not being obedient to God. And I'm not telling you, I'm not going to be like Creflo Dollar here and say, you know, you people ought to tithe to us. You know, we're doing God's work and we need your help. I'd just soon you send it somewhere else. I mean, I really would. But I will tell you that if you've ever performed a rebellious act as vengeance against a pastor or a church, you should probably repent because you are not being led by the Spirit of God to do it. I hope I'm making myself clear, and I don't want you to misunderstand me and understand where I'm getting, because I mean, I'm trying to be on the right side of issues. But I will tell you that vengeance does not belong to you. Jezebel says, I'll kill him if it's the last thing I do, I'm going to kill him. That's a spirit of vengeance inside of a marriage. Inside of a marriage. Well, she can't talk to me that way. So you turn a cold shoulder to your own wife. You're not going to fix nothing around the house. You're not going to pay attention to her. You're not going to give her love and comfort. You little Jezebel. Same thing for you, wife. Your husband doesn't toe the line with you, well, he's getting nothing from me, I'll tell you that right now. You know what that is? That's a harlot. When you trade romance for something that the man's going to do for you, like pay you or something like that, that's a harlot. It's vengeance. Vengeance belongs to God. If you don't like how your husband's doing, you know what you do? You go pray for him. You pray for him. You ask God, God, please fix him. God, do something, because I don't want to be Jezebel. Guys, same way with you. I want to move on. So I love you. I love you enough to tell you the truth. There are ways that we have learned in this world that are not of God. They feel right, and they may sound reasonable to us, but they're not from God. And we've learned how to accept the wrong spirit in our lives. Now, 1 Kings 21. Let me get back to this here, because this is the story of Naboth and his vineyard. Naboth was a man, apparently didn't have any offspring, had no children yet. And Naboth, according to the law of God, had received a parcel of property from his father, who received it from his father and from his father, and it goes all the way down the lineage. Naboth was actually prohibited by law from giving this land to somebody else or from selling it. He couldn't have done it. He would have been breaking the law of God. And so Ahab comes to him and says, give me thy vineyard that I may have it for a garden of herbs. This is 1 Kings 21. That I may have it for a garden of herbs, because it is near unto my house, and I will give thee for it a better vineyard than it. Or if it seem good to thee, I will give thee the worth of it in money. Now, Ahab had no right to that. He didn't even have a right to ask for it. He wasn't even a near kinsman, so he had no right. He had no claim to this whatsoever. He should have never asked, but he did. And Naboth said, I can't sell it to you, king. I mean, I know you're the king, but I can't. The law is bigger than you are, and I can't sell it to you. I have to keep this, and if I ever have a son, I have to hand it down to him. And if I don't have a son, then it's going to go to my cousin Frank over here, and he's going to give it to his sons. But it has to be done that way. I mean, that's just how it is. Naboth was just being right with God. And Ahab went off and he pouted and he cried, why can't I have that? And he wanted that land, okay? And there are lots of vineyards, and I preached on this, and there's been some other good sermons about that, but I want you to think about this, because in verse 5 of 1 Kings chapter 21, the Bible says, but Jezebel his wife came to him and said unto him, why is thy spirit so sad, thou that eatest no bread? Okay? And he said unto her, because I spake unto Naboth the Jezreelite, and said unto him, give me thy vineyard for money, or else, if it please thee, I will give thee another vineyard for it. And he answered, I will not give thee my vineyard. And Jezebel his wife said unto him, dost thou now govern the kingdom of Israel? Arise and eat bread, and let thine heart be merry. I will give thee the vineyard of Naboth the Jezreelite. Now, there's four things that I want to pull out of this one verse here. Number one, this represents satisfied covetousness. The Jezebel spirit will always seek about to satisfy your covetous desires. Okay? So be careful what you're coveting after. Be careful what you're lusting after, because Jezebel is always right there, and she says, you know what? I can get that for you. I can get that for you. You guys who lust after other women, you need to be real careful. Because if you're not, Jezebel knows exactly the right woman who wants to sleep with you, and you'll be committing adultery and busting your marriage wide open. Okay? That's how she works. She says, you know what, is that what you want? I can get that for you. By the way, be careful of people that are always giving you gifts all the time too. Okay? They're flattering you. They're prepping you up for something. All right? So anyway, she represents satisfied covetousness. Number two, she represents a disregard for the law. She didn't care about the law. Remember, her ways are movable that thou canst not know them. She hates rules. And she says, that's what, that stupid law? Is that what's holding you back, that law? It changed laws, okay? Supreme Court, or this judge, this federal judge in California said, what constitution? What amendment? You know, you can't do that. These people are gay, okay? And it's like that in just about every realm of political life in this country. There is a Jezebel spirit there that doesn't care anything about laws. She has no regard for the law whatsoever. Doesn't like rules, doesn't like guidelines, doesn't like standards. Okay? And I'm not a legalist by any stretch of the imagination. I mean, I got a worldly streak in me a mile long. I mean, I'm just being honest, that's how it is. But there are rules and there are standards. I believe in this Bible. Did you know that this Bible has a standard in two verses that I know of in the Bible of how long your breeches are supposed to be when you put them on? Did you know that? Number one, the law said that when a priest put on his breeches, that they were to go down from his waist down to his knee so that his thigh and his nakedness would be covered. And I think it's in Isaiah, talks about the virgin daughter of Babylon says, uncover thy nakedness and uncover thy thighs. Two verses in the Bible that tell you that a naked thigh is immodest. It's a symbol of nakedness. But you have all these people run around and say, well, there's nothing wrong with my shorts. Okay, and you look at them and go, good grief. I mean, you hate to even hardly look at them because they're lascivious. They're not right. Okay? Oh, well, that's not in the Bible. You're a legalist. And they always want to plant you as a legalist and tell you all these things that you're really not, because you believe that there are standards given to you in the Word of God. These standards that we don't just pick and choose what we want to do and how we live our lives. This Bible has a way of telling us. But Jezebel has a disregard for the law. Number three, she's a usurper of authority. Okay? Naboth, and there's two things here, usurper of authority and usurper of rights. Naboth has not only authority over this land, because it's his land, but he has a right to this land, given to him an inalienable right, which means it cannot be leaned against. You cannot file a lien against it. You cannot take it away for any reason, because they're given to us. This right was given to him by God. Naboth had an absolute right over this land. Nobody could take it. I want you to think about All these UN declarations that are becoming manifest in the United States of America, and all the treaties that we're entering into in this country to take away your land and the rights to your land. This is the spirit of Jezebel, but a usurper of rights in this country. When they start, I said I wouldn't talk about any news stories. A federal judge just ruled this week that that's not against the law for any government agent to put a GPS tracker underneath your car without your knowledge and track every place you're going. So it's not, the government can do that. We're going to lose all of our rights in this country. And what spirit is that? Jezebel. She seeks to deprive Naboth of his rights to his land, and she seeks to usurp the authority that he has over that. And I want to tell you something. You listen to this. Your kids are listening to Jezebel songs in their head. When they're listening to songs, some of the songs on the radio, country music, doesn't matter, rap music, rock and roll music, some of this love music that's out there, American Idol, most of this music is designed to usurp the authority of parents. This usurp authority of parents is being taught in it's being taught in Sunday school classrooms. It's being taught everywhere. How do you feel about when your parents discipline? How does that make you feel? Maybe if you had a dialogue with your parents, maybe they could see something they never saw before. That is usurping your parents' authority. And here it is in the church. I'm not a dictator, and I've been accused of being one. I mean, you got to know me. I mean, you don't just know me by watching me on the internet. I mean, you got to come here and you got to know me. I believe there's a certain way to do things, and I'm not perfect by any stretch of the imagination. Man, if you knew how flawed I was. But just because I make mistakes does not mean that I'm not the spiritual head of this church. When you get pulled over by a cop, and you, I mean, he turns the siren on, you pull over the side of the road, does that mean he's a better man than you are? More moral? No. Just means that he has authority, and he has the authority to pull you over and ask you for your license. He has that authority in this country. And any time in a church, when Jezebel's there, she will always usurp biblical authority. Whether it's the husband over a wife, the pastor over a church, or the laws over a country and over its politicians, she will always usurp authority. 1 Kings chapter 21, verse 8, so she wrote letters in Ahab's name. And see, I've even had people write letters. Okay, she wrote letters in Ahab's name and sealed them with his. Why didn't she sign her name to it? Because there's something about Jezebel you need to know, that she always operates behind the scenes in darkness and in secret. Okay? Here's the Bible right here, and any secret that you ever want to know, all you got to do is ask God, and He'll reveal it to you in the Scriptures. That's a promise He made, okay? Here is Morals and Dogma. Morals and Dogma, which is the Masonic, it's kind of like Masonic Bible. Morals and Dogma starts out here, esoteric book, which means it's a secret. Don't tell anybody what's in here, okay? She conceals, He reveals. She always works, and so you see this symbol here on Marilyn Ferguson's Aquarian Conspiracy, and then you see it here in the New King James Version of the Bible. See, they match. They match really well, okay? You could have a bedspread with this on it, and you could have drapes with this on it because they match, okay? Why won't they tell you what it means? Okay? Why won't they tell you the truth about what it means? She conceals, He reveals. And so she is working behind the scenes. Okay? She works through deacon boards. She works through boards. She works through people in the church. And she will always be working behind that spirit, whether she's in a man or a woman in the church, she will always be working behind the scenes. So she wrote letters in Ahab's name and sealed them with his seal and sent letters unto the elders to the nobles that were in his city dwelling with Naboth. She wrote in the letters saying, proclaim a fast and set Naboth on high among the people. See, she sounds religious, doesn't she? We're going to have a big fast here. We're going to set Naboth on high. Okay. Now verse 10. And she set two men, sons of Belial. Boy, there's a loaded deal right there. Before him to bear witness against him, saying, thou didst blaspheme God and the king, and then carry him out and stone him that he may die. In other words, she's already got this all figured out. She has already portrayed or played the part of jury and executioner, judge, jury, and executioner. Okay, this is already a worked out deal how it's going to be. And she works behind the scenes. She doesn't mind lying. Okay, boy, think about that one for a while. She will always lie and to get her way, and she'll even set up witnesses. Now say this. Now say this. Now say this. That is the spirit of Jezebel. And the men of his city, even the elders and the nobles who were the inhabitants in his city, did as Jezebel had sent unto them, and as it was written in the letters which she had sent unto them. She is the mother conspirator. Okay, you really need to believe in a conspiracy theory, the one that's laid out in the Bible. You really need to get that, because there is one, and she is the mother of all those conspiracies. Now I want to stop right here. For some of you who have not been watching us very long, we have a whole video set called Jesus Christ DNA, the Holy Bible, and it amazing, amazing things that God is showing us about the Bible and DNA. Number two, a video called The Mother of All Secrets, and I called it that because the mother is Mystery Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. And the secret that is out there is her secret that she is trying desperately to conceal. And so then the third one is called Triple Helix. And if you don't have those DVDs, I encourage you to get a copy of them so that you can watch them and copy them and give them out to others is what we want. So call our office or write us or send us an email. If you want to throw in a donation, we would appreciate it because it costs us to get them out there. But anyway, she always works behind the scenes, and she is the mother of the conspiracy. There was a conspiracy against Naboth, and she's the one that started it all. Okay? So she is the mother conspirator. She works behind the scenes. Look at verse 14. Then they sent to Jezebel, saying, Naboth is stoned and is dead. And it came to pass when Jezebel heard that Naboth was stoned and was dead, that Jezebel said to Ahab, Arise, take possession of the vineyard of Naboth, the Jezreelite, which he refused to give thee for money, for Naboth is not alive but dead. Now, here's what I get out of this. I ask myself the question. She's the one that brought everybody to this big meeting. She set up the conspirators. She told the liars to say what they say. She probably had the guards say, now, as soon as they convict him, take him and go out and stone him with stones. I mean, she worked out this whole deal. But she wasn't at the meeting. She was back at home. Okay? She did not want her face to be present there. That's why they came and told her of those things that had been done. She won't dare go out there herself. But she'll get you to do it. Ladies, listen to me. Now, I know the man is to be the man of the house, and he's to stand up for issues that pertain to the house, and I understand that. Ladies, be careful about how you're manipulating your husband. Okay? Be careful. If you fill his head full of your grief and say, now you go do what I said, and then you draw back in the background, okay? If you send him out to do something, I think I'd be there with him. Okay? He's going to need that support. If it's the right issue, he's going to need that support. Okay? Now, I'm just telling you. Let's not have a Jezebel spirit in our lives, okay? Now, 1 Kings chapter 21, verse 25. But there was none, listen to this. There was none like unto Ahab. Look at Ahab's fault. Which did sell himself to work wickedness in the sight of the Lord, whom Jezebel his wife stirred up. She's a stirrer. You ever had somebody stirring up trouble in your house? You ever had somebody stirring up trouble amongst your kids? You ever had somebody stirring up trouble in your church? She loves to stir it up. She loves to drive people against God and against God's ways, and especially against righteousness. The wickedness, I mean, Ahab was a sinner, and he's kind of like me, and he's kind of like you. He's just a sinner. But there's a spirit that takes people from just being a normal sin to being in the fast lane of wickedness. And it's Jezebel. Think about where this country is right now with the iniquity, and think about the spirit that has stirred us up in the last, let's say, 50 to 60 years. Think about the spirit that has stirred up in this nation the wickedness and the idolatry and the lasciviousness that has been stirred up in this nation. By who? by Jezebel. Okay, remember, she represents fulfilled covetousness. Be careful about what your eyes are looking at, about what you're lusting after, what you're fantasizing after. Be careful, because she is all too eager to keep you satisfied. You think about that. Oh, look at this. 2 Kings chapter 9, 22. See, Jehu, God raised up Jehu. Jehu went out there and he said, I'm going to kill her. I've had it with Jezebel. I'm done. And I will tell you, pastor, husband, wife, even children, politician, at some point, you're going to have to stand up and say, you know what? I may get my head cut off, but I've had it. I'm done. You need to stand up and face her. You need to get you a little Holy Ghost boldness in you and stand up and say, you know what? We're not doing this. This is not God's way, and it's not right. And I can't stand for it. Preaching the truth takes its toll. And when Jezebel gets busy and she starts working and she gets really, really entrenched in a church, and you stand up against her, you will pay the price. Elijah, after dealing with her, run off and said, okay, Lord, it's enough. Take away my life, for I'm not better than my father's. Go ahead and kill me now. Okay? I mean, that's what she drove him to. I've been there. I have been there. I've been there because of other people, but I will also tell you out of fairness that I've been there because it's been self-inflicted. Inflicted? Yeah. Self-inflicted. Okay? I've been there both ways. Neither one of them's fun. And I'm just telling you, be careful. But when it's time to stand, you stand. So Jehu comes. Okay, now I want you to listen to this. There's a load of wisdom in this one verse here. 2 Kings 9:22, and it came to pass when Joram saw Jehu that he said, is it peace, Jehu? And he answered, what peace? So long as the whoredoms of thy mother Jezebel and her witchcrafts are so many. Now, I'll stop right here. There's several things here. Number one, there will be no peace so long as Jezebel is allowed to do what she's doing. There will not be peace in your family. Husbands and wives, pay attention to this. I love a peaceful marriage. I love and crave peace. And my wife and I, after 23 years, We've kind of worked on each other. We've kind of worked on ourselves and developed in our marriage, and we pretty much know when to shut up and know when to stop. We've just learned that over the years, because both of us have gone way too far. Okay? I mean, we've gone way too far. And we've learned over the years when it's time to shut up. We learned that. We've learned when it's time to get over it, when it's time to forgive. We know all these things because we want more than our own will. We want marriage to typify the relationship between Christ and His church. That's what we want more than anything. It takes work. I mean, it takes work. I understand this, okay? And so, by and large, my wife and I, we have a peaceful relationship with each other. We have a peaceful home. Try to have a peaceful home. Not perfect. Okay? We're not June and Ward Cleaver. Okay? That's not who we are. But we like to have peace. But as long as Jezebel's there, I'm telling you, there is no peace. Okay? There will be no peace in that home. Peace in with your relationship with your children. And as long as there is a Jezebel influence either on them or on you, there will be no peace between you and your children. In a church situation where Jezebel, and I remember one day, I mean, there was just something all over me, and I could not shake it to save my life. And I prayed and I prayed and I prayed and I said, God, what is going on here, God? And I fasted and prayed, and God, please show me. And it's one of those deals where I said, God, I'm going to open up the Bible now, and I really need you to show me this. So I opened up, of all places, to 2 Kings chapter 9, verse 2. I mean, just open my Bible there. You know how that works. I mean, that works a million times. And I thought, well, no, it's not going to be there. And I went to turn the page, and the Holy Ghost said, stop. Read where your hand is. And I read 2 Kings 9:22. Is it peace? And Jehu said, what peace, so long as the whoredoms of thy mother Jezebel and her witchcraft are so many? And that's it. And in 2 days' time, God revealed to me a Jezebel spirit working through a person in this building. And it was gone that afternoon. Okay? It took its toll, but it was gone that afternoon. And I'm just telling you that there is no peace as long as she's alive. Think about it. Think about the turmoil that's in our country. Think about all the people that are protesting the Tea Party movement, the Ground Zero mosque people. Think about all the groups that are at each other's throat in this country. Who's doing that? Jezebel, her whoredoms, and her witchcraft, that's exactly what's leading all of this in our country right now, and it's meant to destroy America. He answered, what peace along is the whoredoms? Number one, she's the mother of harlots, okay? Number two, her witchcrafts, okay? Witchcraft, that's a big thing. Look at 1 Samuel chapter 15, verse 23. For rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft, and stubbornness is as iniquity and idolatry. Rebellion is as witchcraft, God said. So he's equating the two. Any place where there's a rebellious spirit, when kids are rebelling against their parents, when moms and dads are fighting one another, there is Jezebel. That spirit is right there. When there is rebellion in a church, when there is rebellion in your life against this book, okay, you didn't like something you read in this book, so you either A, you went and got you a new King James, because it didn't say that in there. My Bible didn't say that in there. You either went and got you a different Bible, or you said, you know, I bet the Hebrew and Greek doesn't say that. And you went and retranslated it, okay? And you didn't like that. Yeah, that's rebellion, and that is witchcraft. Paul said, well, where is that verse? I had that in here. I know I did. Paul was talking about who hath bewitched you, O foolish Galatians. I probably got that a little bit later on. Now look at 2 Kings chapter 9. And when Jehu was come to Jezreel, notice how Jezebel deals with this. Jezebel heard of it, and she painted her face. See, I told you I'd get to that paint face thing. And tired her head. Now that does not mean that she put tires on her head. It means that she put makeup on her face and she attired her head. In other words, she went out to allure him. She went out to look good because that's the only thing that she knows. She's shallow. She knows no other way. Oh, Jehu's coming. He's a man. I got this. I mean, I can control this man. So she went out and made herself look good. It didn't work. Jehu said, who's on the Lord's side? I need two or three of you. And two or three of them grabbed her and threw her out the window. And that was her end. But she's the mother of harlots. Now let's jump to Revelation chapter 2, verse 20. I want you to look at this for a minute. Because now we've gone from Old Testament Jezebel to New Testament Jezebel. And I want you to look at this. This is the church of Thyatira. And Jesus says a few nice things about this church. But then he says, notwithstanding, I have a few things against thee, because thou sufferest or allowest that woman, Jezebel. Now I want you to look at this. Which calleth herself a prophetess. Stop right here. She is self-appointed. She's self-anointed. She is, she has elected herself. You know, who made you queen? I did. Okay? That's her. When she goes around in a place, let's say that you're a man. In any place where you don't have authority, if you try to have authority, you're Jezebel. If you got no place there, then you got no place. And I know some people that whenever they get into any social situation, they have got to be right at the top of things. It's Jezebel. That's her. But think about this. In a church situation, and if you hadn't liked anything I said up till now, you're fixing to hate my guts. Because I'm going to tell you the truth according to the Word of God. And what your problem is that you believed man. You've believed man over the Bible. Or you believed woman over the Bible. Okay? Now I want you to listen to this. Number one, she calls herself a prophetess because God did not call her. She is not called of God. Number two, which calleth herself a prophetess, thou sufferest that woman Jezebel to do what? To teach. In fact, Let me show you the graphic. There is Joyce Myers, and there is Gloria Copeland, and there is Paula White, and I could put thousands of pictures up here of these self-appointed Jezebels who are teaching. Oh, Pastor Mike, I mean, that's under the law. No, it wasn't under the law. Well, you know, that was, let's go back and look what the Bible says. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 11. Let the woman learn how, in silence, with all subjection. But I suffer not, which means I allow not a woman to teach, nor to usurp authority over the man, but to be in silence. For Adam was first formed, then Eve, and Adam was not deceived, but the woman being deceived was in the transgression. Now I'm going to stop right here, and I'm not going to say one word about this verse. Because everybody that goes against this verse, they always say, well, you know, that we now know, you know, I heard so-and-so say that that's, you know, those are the traditions then and back then, back then. So I'm not going to say anything. I want you to read this verse again. Let the woman learn in silence with all subjection, but I suffer not a woman to teach, nor to usurp authority over the man, but to be in silence. For Adam was first formed, then Eve, and Adam was not deceived, but the woman, being deceived, was in the transgression. I'm not going to say a word. That's just what God said. Back to Revelation chapter 2. You suffer her to teach, number 1, and number 2, to seduce my servants to commit fornication. The lasciviousness that is in the church right now is beyond belief. It is absolutely beyond. And how many pastors do you think? And in fact, we don't have to think. How many pastors are under the direct influence of Jezebel because of pornography or having a lascivious affair or any number of things? How many pastors are like that all around the world? It's a shame. It is an absolute shame. She has seduced his servants to commit fornication. And they eat same things sacrificed unto idols. And I gave her space to repent of her fornication, and she repented not. Would you listen to this? See, we got more of Jezebel in us than we like to admit. Well, I'm not sorry. I'm not apologizing to him. I'm not apologizing. Anybody that won't repent, you're a Jezebel. Learn how to say I'm sorry, male or female. In fact, the women, usually it's easier for them to say it than it is the man. Both learn how to repent and learn how to forgive. Learn those things. Here's this verse I was looking for in Galatians. O foolish Galatians, who hath bewitched you that you should not obey the truth, before whose eyes Jesus Christ have been evidently set forth, crucified among you? This only would I learn of you: received ye the spirit of the works of the law, or by the hearing of faith? In other words, her ways are to bring you into a false gospel built upon works. And Paul used the right word when he used witchcraft. Okay, she is seducing people in the church, and she's bringing in a spirit of witchcraft in there. Now, here's what God said. Here's what Jesus said in Revelation chapter 2. He said, behold, I will cast her into a bed, and them that commit adultery with her into great tribulation, except they repent of their deeds. God is giving you a space to repent right now. And you know what? In the course of this Watchman broadcast, I have indicted myself in teaching this. Okay? I'm just telling you the truth. I have indicted myself in teaching this. And you know, it's my responsibility that when I see Jezebel's ways or her influence in my life, it's my responsibility to repent and say, God, please, don't let her have control over me. And I'm pretty sure that the Word of God has indicted me, that it should have indicted you. There should be a conviction in your heart about some of your ways, and you need to repent. And God's given you time. He said, I'm giving her a space to repent. Will she? I hope she does, because if she doesn't, I'm going to cast her into a bed. She's going to be raped there. them that commit adultery with her, and I'm going to cast them into great tribulation. Now I'm going to tell you something. If you're not careful, please get victory over Jezebel. How do we do that? I mean, she's entrenched. She's powerful. She has a position of authority in it. Here's how. Back to Proverbs 7. My son, keep my words and lay up my commandments with thee. Keep my commandments and live, and my law as the apple of thine eye. Bind them upon thy fingers and write them upon the table of thine heart. Say unto wisdom, thou art my sister, and called understanding. See, that's the virtuous woman there. Wisdom and is your sister, and called understanding thy kinswoman. That they may keep thee from the strange woman, from the stranger, which flattereth with her words. That's how she, I want to tell you something. You know how she's defeated? By the written word. By the written word. This Bible right here. The Constitution. That's how she is defeated. And again, if you see a little Jezebel in you, repent. God will take you back. God will heal you. God will forgive you. God will cast her into tribulation while He is exalting you. But God's given you space now to repent. You need to repent. Well, no trips to McDonald's in this Watchman broadcast. No funny videos or anything like that. But this is a Watchman ministry. And I want you to be watching for what's not only going on in Area 51 or the Stargate's going to be opened or anything. Not only be watching for that, but be watching right here in your own soul. Quickly, I'd like to reintroduce you again. We have books here by divine order, the King James Code. I wrote these a few years ago. They deal with scripture numerics. A lot of teaching in here as well. A lot of the typology and the language structure of the Bible is written into these two books. And I know we've talked about them before, but some of you are new viewers. And if you don't have copies of these books, we'll send them to you. We print them all here, cover them and everything like that. We print them all here at our top secret broadcasting compound. And if you'd like to get copies of this, just call us, write us, email us, let us know. We'll give them to you, but it does cost us some money to put these together, and so if you can help us out, we appreciate it. If you can help us out in our ministry, if you'd like to be on our watchers list, we'll send you every DVD and CD that we put out each month. We'll send that to you, and if you'll just remember to support us monthly. Those of you who are not on our watchers list and watch us over the internet, if you would just like to say, hey, you know what, I think I want to kick in a couple bucks here and there. I mean, we would appreciate that, because as our ministry grows, our expenses are growing. Our church here is not growing all that much, but our outside ministry is expanding greatly. And if you can help us out, I'm telling you, we definitely would appreciate it. But don't do anything that God does not tell you to do. Okay, is that fair enough? Don't do anything that God does not tell you to do. All right, I've kept you long enough. This is Pastor Mike. I love you. I really do. And I tell you the truth in love. I tell you the truth in love. And the truth, listen, you want peace? As soon as Jezebel's gone, I'm telling you, you'll feel better. I promise you will. I love you. God bless you. We'll see you next time. Bye.
Welcome to Number 7 Ministries Christian Outreach. Today's sermon is called Seven Signs of a False Prophet. And we're going to expose some characteristics of how to recognize a false prophet. The first sign or indication that we have a false prophet is a false prophet will completely deny the deity of Jesus Christ. So, a false prophet will try to dethrone the deity of Jesus Christ. They will try to take away the fact that Jesus was God. And you have a lot of religions that are acting under the false prophet's spirit by saying that Jesus was just a man. He was just a prophet. So they're saying he was prophesying, but he wasn't the Son of God. They will say that he was gifted, he performed miracles. They have no problems acknowledging those things. But when it comes to recognizing his deity, him being a Son of God, they will try to dethrone him and strip him of that. A lot of religions that do that with Jesus are the Muslims will do that. The Muslims will acknowledge that Jesus did miracles, that he was a prophet, that God used him, but they will dethrone the deity of him, the fact that he was God himself. The same thing with the Jewish people. The Jewish people will recognize that Jesus was a prophet, that he was gifted, but again, they will dethrone the deity. And you have a lot of proclaiming Christian churches that will say, Jesus is great, he was used mightily of God, but he's not the only way to heaven. See, these are signs of what a false prophet will do. So they might, everything in the outward appearance will look like a Christian organization. They could use King James Bibles. They can pray. They can even use Jesus' name in their prayers. But in their teaching, in their preaching, they will not acknowledge that Jesus is the Son of God. They will reject that. And so this is the number one key for us to know of a sign that we're dealing with the false prophet. In 1 John chapter 4, verse 3, it says, "But every spirit that does not acknowledge Jesus is not from God. This is the spirit of the Antichrist, which you have heard is coming, and even now is already in the world." So look at how that Bible verse was written. It said, "This is the spirit of the Antichrist, which you have heard is coming, and even now is already in the world." So this is telling us that the spirit of the Antichrist or the false prophet is existing in this world today. He or she or this spirit is already in operation right now. But it's also saying that this spirit is going to be coming too, or you heard that it's coming, because this spirit is going to climb the ladder of spiritual wickedness in high places. This spirit is going to climb the ladder of political position. This spirit is going to climb the ladder of the entertainment industry, so that this spirit of Antichrist can influence masses of people. He's going for the gusto. Yeah, is he going to go into the nitty-gritty crevices of small churches and big churches and try to influence there? Yeah, he's all throughout the world. And this is why, as Christians, we need to know and be aware of signs that indicate that this is a false prophet, so we don't get deceived and we don't get misled. Because the ultimate goal of the Antichrist is to lead people to hell. Lead people to hell. Number two, a second sign of a false prophet is teaches contrary to what Jesus taught. So here you have, in the first sign, they deny the deity of Jesus, but you can also deny the deity of Jesus by teaching against what Jesus taught. So if Jesus said it's better to give than to receive, and someone teaches the opposite of that, then they're actually operating on the spirit of Antichrist by teaching the opposite of what Jesus taught. And those that are into satanic cults, those that are devil worshipers, in their rituals of Satanism, part of their practice is to do the opposite of what the Bible teaches, to read the Bible backwards, to do exactly the opposite of what Jesus taught. So this is another indication to recognize that we are dealing with a false prophet. In 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 3, If any man teaches otherwise and consist not to wholesome words, even the words of our Lord Jesus Christ, and to the doctrine which is according to godliness. So this is a Bible verse that is indicating the extreme importance that we embrace the teachings of Jesus Christ. And I'm going to tell you this, that anyone who feels the need to go to an outside source outside of the Bible and to preach off of that, you're going in the direction of a false prophet, because you're saying that the teachings of Jesus were not enough, that we have to go to an outside source. Indirectly, when you start to use different sources outside of the Bible, you're starting to take on the spirit of a false prophet. Because I've found through personal experience that the teachings of Jesus Christ are more than adequate to deliver addictions, more than adequate to cast out demons, more than adequate to save our souls, more than adequate to comfort us, to guide us, to lead us, to direct us, and to give us the ability to discern evil from good. The words of Jesus Christ are more than adequate. So for us to start being prideful and saying that we've mastered the words of Jesus and now we're above the words of Jesus, that we need to use other sources outside of the Bible, this person is so lifted up in pride that they're being counterproductive and God is already rejecting them. So let's humble ourselves and let's be wise and fear the Lord, fear Jesus, and believe that his words are sufficient. So as of now, we have the two signs of a false prophet. We have denies the deity of Jesus. We have number two, teaches contrary to what Jesus taught. And then we're going to get ready to go into the third sign. The third sign of a false prophet is that he or she has the love of money. And let me tell you, when a false prophet has the love of money, their whole entire life will be perceived from the basis of the love of money. This is how a false prophet is able to preach from Genesis to Revelation about money. Every single scripture that they preach, they somehow put a twist in it and they bring it back to money. And they will start to glorify the power and the value of money above the power and the value of Jesus Christ. And anytime you see someone doing that, you know that you're dealing with a false prophet. Because the Bible does not value money over Jesus. The Bible never says that money in and of itself is evil. It says that the love of money is evil. And those that are false prophets have the love of money. And that is good. Now again, remember, a false prophet could just have one or two of these signs. And in order for a false prophet to be most effective, he will probably only have one of two of these signs. Because if he has all of these signs, people will recognize them and just shut down. And he won't be able to manipulate anyone. So the devil is very, very crafty. Very, very crafty. And let's read the proof in the Bible. In 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 5, it says, perverse, which means corrupt or evil, perverse disputings of men of corrupt minds, and destitute of the truth, which means absence from the truth, or empty of the truth, or not having any truth, supposing that gain is godliness. From such withdraw thyself. The Bible right here in 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 5, it says, those that suppose godliness is gain. In other words, they connect with the more money you have, the more godly you are. They try to say the more materialism you have, the greater your bank account is, the more blessed you are. But the Bible is teaching that that is not true. And it actually tells us that those that teach those sort of things, we should actually leave their presence because they are not of God. Does it feel good to our flesh? Yes. Does the flesh want to hear that because you are of God, you're going to get more and more money? Yes, the flesh wants to hear it. Yes, it feels good. Yes, it encourages us, but it encourages us away from Jesus. Remember, Jesus was born in a barn. Jesus was born in the most poorest of poor places, and he was the epitome of God. He was God. And so if we say that godliness is gain, then we're saying that Jesus was ungodly because he was born in the poorest of places. The two cannot go together. Can a person be rich and be of God? Yes, but he is not proven to be of God because of his riches. He is proven to be of God because of his relationship with Jesus Christ and that alone. Whether he's poor or rich is irrelevant from a relationship and a commitment to Christ. Now, the devil has the means and the power and the resources given by God for a season to give people riches. So that alone does not prove whether a person is of God. So I'm going to read this Bible verse again. If any man teaches otherwise, perverse disputings of men of corrupt minds, destitute of the truth, supposing that gain is godliness, from such withdraw thyself. In 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 7, the Lord makes poor and makes rich. He brings low and lifts up. So here we have a Bible verse saying, and I know the money hungry, greedy, prosperity, false prophets preach that the devil comes to steal, kill, and destroy. And they say steal as if the devil's going to steal the money. But let me tell you this. Let me ask you this. Do you believe the devil's more concerned about stealing someone's faith or stealing their money? The devil's more concerned about stealing their faith because he knows if he steals their faith, they can't be saved. But if he steals their money, now they no longer have money to depend on, and they have to depend on God. So sometimes the devil will actually steal from us by giving us money and resources. So the Lord makes poor and makes rich, which means that God has the power and sometimes makes a rich person poor. God has the power to take a person who's powerful in this world and bring them down low. Now, why would God do that? God would do that to save their soul. Because if they're depending too much on their money, too much on their power in the natural, too much on their resources, that they turn their back on God and they feel like they are God because of how much money they have, God, because of his infinite wisdom and love, will actually take the money from that person to save their soul. So that as the person loses their God, which is money, they cry out in pain. They cry out in desperation, and then God will be right there to rescue them. So this is a third sign, an indication of a false prophet. He has or she has the love of money. The fourth sign or indication of a false prophet is a false prophet will try to steal God's glory. King David said, "Touch not the Lord's anointed." Now, in that sense, he said, don't do no harm to God's anointed, God's chosen people. But the devil will not only try to touch God's anointing, he will try to steal credit for what God is doing. In other words, God causes a homeless person to get delivered from drugs, get delivered from alcohol. God will give this person a job, a house, a car, and raise a homeless person from nothing to being a respected citizen in this life. God did it. And then a false prophet will come along and remove the credit from God, remove the glory from God, remove the divine intervention from God, and the false prophet will try to make that homeless person who's now no longer homeless say that you did it yourself. It was by your wisdom. It was by your strength. It was by your powers, by your motivation, your will, your self-control, your mental aptitude. They will try to steal God's credit, steal God's glory. That is another major red flag, another major indication that you're dealing with a false prophet. They will try to steal God's glory. They won't give God credit for nothing. And remember, something that is glorious is something that other people don't do. All right. Why is it that Jesus has glory when he died on the cross? Other people died on the cross like Jesus. There was a thief to the left and to the right of him. So the glory of Jesus is not that he died on the cross, because there were hundreds and thousands of people that died on the cross just like Jesus did. Jesus' glory is not that he was beaten, not that he was falsely accused, not that he was stabbed in the side, because that happened to millions of people. So it can't be as glory. See, glory is something that no one else has. If you can bench press 100 pounds and everyone that walks in the gym can bench press 100 pounds, then nobody has any glory. But if you can bench press 100 pounds and someone comes in and bench presses 500 pounds, now all of a sudden the person that did greater has the glory because he's above everyone else. Well, Jesus' glory did not come from dying on the cross alone. Jesus' glory did not come from suffering alone, because a lot of people suffered. Jesus' glory came from who he is. Who he is a man of God, a child of God, a son of God, the Lamb of God that was born from a virgin. Who else do you know that was born from a virgin? Only Jesus. That is his glory. Who else do you know that died without sin? That was Jesus and Jesus alone. That is his glory. The glory of Jesus, that he was the sacrifice. He paid the price for our sins and he had no sin in him. He was born of a virgin, and no one else was born of a virgin. All the other stuff that Jesus did, the healing the blind, the raising the dead, the miracles, other men of God have done those things too. And you're going to have masses of false prophets try to steal the glory of God. And in stealing the glory of God, they will present themselves as they too are without sin. A false prophet will never share his testimony because he doesn't have one. If he had a testimony of Jesus, then he probably wouldn't be a false prophet. So this is another indication of recognize a false prophet. That he will not give any credit to Jesus Christ. Isaiah chapter 14, verse 14. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds, and I will be like the Most High. So here you have a scripture of an example of Satan when he went from Lucifer, an angel, an anointed angel, to becoming a demonic fallen angel. When he tried to raise up or raise to become equal with God, he was trying to steal God's glory. Number five, the fifth sign of a false prophet is a false prophet will have a hidden agenda that he will not share with other people. There will be something that he is up to that he will not make known to the congregation, or that he will not make known to the general public. Because if the people know what he's really up to, they won't follow him. And let me tell you this, these hidden agendas take place in all assets of life. Whether you realize it or not, I'm talking about in the legal and the legal field, with the court systems and the political systems, the people in the politics, they have hidden agendas that they're not sharing with you, because if they shared with you, they wouldn't be able to bring them to pass, because we would try to stop them. Even in the legal system, they have hidden agendas that they're doing that the general public never finds out. People that are in control of the news and the media, they have hidden agendas that they're up to that they don't share with the general population, because if we knew, we'd try to stop them. And I'm going to say the same thing is true with the false prophets that are proclaiming to be pastors, proclaiming to be men or women of God. They have hidden agendas that they're not going to share with the general congregation, or they would try to stop them. In Deuteronomy chapter 13, verse 1, if there arise among you a prophet or a dreamer of dreams and gives you a sign or a wonder, and the sign or wonder comes to pass, he spoke unto you, and he says, let us go after other gods, which you have not known, and let us serve them. So this is one of the hidden agendas of a false prophet, is that he will try to get the people that are watching him, that he has an audience with, he will try to indirectly or secretly get them to serve other gods. What is an example of another god? It could be a car, it could be a house, it could be a woman, it could be a man, it could be money. Try to make people follow other gods. You shall not hearken unto their words of that prophet or that dreamer of dreams, for the Lord your God is testing you to know whether you love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul. And let me tell you that these false prophets will be given the ability by Satan and the permission by God to prophesy, and their prophecy will come to pass. The Bible says that these false prophets will be given power to perform many signs and wonders. They will actually have the ability to actually perform great, miraculous, spectacular signs and wonders and do things so that they will be able to deceive masses of people. So if someone comes and raises the dead, or someone comes and heals the blind, or someone does a great work, that great work in itself does not prove that that's a man of God. That just proved that they did a great work. We don't know whether that great work was funded by Jesus Christ or by Satan until we look and inspect to see if that person has the fruit of the Spirit. We do not know a false prophet from a real prophet by their gifts, which means their ability to preach, their ability to teach, their ability to heal. We don't know whether that's a false prophet or a true prophet by the gift alone. We know whether it's a false prophet or a true prophet by the fruits of the Spirit. Do they have love? Do they have gentleness? Do they have meekness? Do they have humility? Do they have peace? Do they have joy? Those are indications of the fruit of the Spirit, which means they are connected and plugged in to Jesus Christ. In verse 3, you shall not hearken unto the words of that prophet and the dreamer of the dreams, for the Lord your God is testing you to know whether you love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul. Number 6 sign of a false prophet, a false prophet has to and must speak smooth. I'm going to tell you, be honest. Are you going to be deceived or misled by a hooping, hollering, screaming, crazy madman? Or are you just going to immediately shut down and not listen to anything that they say? I'm going to tell you, those that are more likely of God are the pastors screaming and yelling and hooping and hollering, because they ain't deceiving nobody. The false prophet is going to be the one to speak. He's going to speak so smooth and so manipulative. And I often try to advise or counsel women in the sense to know a man who is no good is a man who always speaks smooth to them, a man who always speaks kind. Because in reality, men have bad days. Men have hard times, and out of their hard times and bad days, they're going to get mad, they're going to get angry, they're going to get upset. So a person who is covering that up and hiding that is a person who's up to something. So a person who's always speaking smooth and always speaking charismatic and soft, that's a person who probably has a hidden agenda and he's going to manipulate someone. In Luke chapter 6, verse 26, it says, "Woe unto you when all men shall speak well of you. So did their fathers to the false prophets." In Lamentations, it says, "The visions of your prophets were false and worthless. They did not expose your sin to ward off your captivity. The oracles they gave you were false and misleading." So in other words, these false prophets will never talk about sin. These false prophets will never mention hell. These false prophets will never mention consequences for sin, because they don't want people to get free. They only wanted to encourage them. They only want to make them feel good, and they only want to mislead them, so they end up pointing people into the direction of hell without them realizing it. Because a true prophet speaks harsh. A true prophet warns people of their sin so that they could be aware of their sin, so that they can feel not condemned but convicted of their sin, so that they can have a chance and an opportunity to repent of their sin, so that they can have a chance and an opportunity to get saved and be forgiven of their sin. Not cover up their sin, not excuse their sin, and not deny their sin like the false prophets try to get the congregation to do. A true prophet will expose the sin and shine the light on the sin so that souls can be saved. And a false prophet makes a lot of friends because he tells people what they want to hear, not what they need to hear. And the truth is, no matter who you are, no matter what your title is, no matter how long you've been serving God, you have sinned. And you are going to sin again. And when you sin again, we need to shine the glorious light of the gospel on our sin so that we can repent of our sin and be forgiven of our sin and be free from the consequences of our sin. And that process is not always a smooth process. That process does not always feel good to our flesh or our pride. The seventh sign or indication of a false prophet is hypocrite. Here you have a man as blue as he wanted to be as blue.
Roger's word is a word for the hour. It is the hour for the body of Christ. Beware of men who bring miracle without fruit. Beware of men who do not display the fruit of the Spirit and yet display the miracle. Beware of men who emphasize what you do not have and yet do not show it in their own lives. Beware of the man that says that we do not pray enough, and yet by his own life and by his own answers to prayer, does not lead you into prayer. There are wolves around. They're going to emerge. When they see there's something worth getting hold of, when they see that there's been something born here, wolves are going to emerge, and they're going to seek to lead the sheep away. And they'll do it either by deceit and by the use of miracle, or by condemnation. This fellowship has already been saved from one such man, as Roger has talked about, 2-3 years ago. We refuse to open the door of this fellowship, and we refuse to open the door of all the fellowships that we were related to. In 3 weeks, I may have told you this before, in 3 weeks, that man had gone round other fellowships and there were 8 cases of immorality in 3 weeks. Why? Because the man had a powerful prophetic gift which covered up deceit in his heart. But Morris and myself smelt that man out, and we did not allow him through that door. So put your trust in your leaders. Put your trust in the household group leaders. We have opened the door to Roger. We believe that he is of the same spirit, that God has dealt with him. Young man though he is, God has laid ministry upon his heart. And as leaders, I just want to say this tonight, every one of us who lead in any way, as wives to our children, as husbands to our families, as local house group leaders to our groups, as elders to the fellowship, as ministries to the nation, we are the doors, just as Jesus was the door. And let us open ourselves up to the good that God is bringing. Let us always be ready to receive from outside, but let us beware of letting anything in. In 1946, Charles Price said, one of the best healing ministries that we've seen, he said that there was going to come a spate of miracles that would damage the body of Christ almost beyond repair. But after that, there would come a true awakening of God that would be greater than anything that the church has ever seen. I believe we are being prepared for such a time as that. Not because we're anything, but because He is everything. And He is going to be manifested through us. Let's just say, Father, the hour is late, but we want to be delivered, A, from the pressure of having to stay when we know we ought to go. We want to be free to be able to leave a meeting. And we also want to be delivered from the tradition of having to finish at 10 o'clock, Lord. We want to be able to finish at 9, quarter to 11. So, Father, we thank you for this time tonight. We thank you for our brother's ministry. We receive it. We embrace it. And we ask that you will establish the doors of our homes, of our fellowships, that whole households may not be subverted by false teachers, but that we are truly covered in these days. Not smothered, Lord, but covered. Bless the elderships. Bless the husbands. Bless the wives. Bless the teenagers that are emerging into leadership of the young. Bless each and every one. Bless the musicians. Let them be doors. Bless the prophets. Bless the practical workers, Lord, that we each one might take up our place, and that in this way you might restore the supernatural element of the church. I know, Lord, we know, Lord, that it's the age of restoration. We're going to see it flooding in. We can't force it. We can't squeeze it out. We've tried, Lord, but you are restoring. The hour is coming, hallelujah, when you're going to manifest your glory in your house. And we're not in it because of that, Lord. We're in it for the eternal blessing and joy of being with you. But we know you're going to manifest that power. So be with us now, we pray in Jesus' name. Consolidate what's been said. Yes. Amen. Roger's word is a word for the hour. It is the hour for the body of Christ. Beware of men who bring miracles without fruit. Beware of men who do not display the fruit of the Spirit and yet display the miracle. Beware of men who emphasize what you do not have and yet do not show it in their own lives. Beware of the man that says that we do not pray enough, and yet by his own life and by his own answers to prayer, does not lead you into prayer. There are wolves around. They're going to emerge. When they see there's something worth getting hold of, when they see that there's been something born here, wolves are going to emerge, and they're going to seek to lead the sheep away. And they'll do it either by deceit and by the use of miracle, or by condemnation. This fellowship has already been saved from one such man, as Roger has talked about, 2-3 years ago. We refuse to open the door of this fellowship, and we refuse to open the door of all the fellowships that we were related to. In 3 weeks, I may have told you this before, In 3 weeks, that man had gone round other fellowships and there were 8 cases of immorality in 3 weeks. Why? Because the man had a powerful prophetic gift which covered up deceit in his heart. But Morris and myself smelt that man out and we did not allow him through that door. So put your trust in your leaders. Put your trust in the household group leaders. We have opened the door to Roger. We believe that he is of the same spirit, that God has dealt with him. Young man though he is, God has laid ministry upon his heart. And as leaders, I just want to say this tonight, every one of us who lead in any way, as wives to our children, as husbands to our families, as local house group leaders to our groups, as elders to the fellowship, as ministries to the nation, we are the doors, just as Jesus was the door. And let us open ourselves up to the good that God is bringing. Let us always be ready to receive from outside, but let us beware of letting anything in. In 1946, Charles Price said, one of the best healing ministries that we've seen, he said that there was going to come a spate of miracles that would damage the body of Christ almost beyond repair. But after that, there would come a true awakening of God that would be greater than anything that the church has ever seen. I believe we are being prepared for such a time as that. Not because we're anything, but because He is everything. And He is going to be manifested through us. Let's just say, Father, the hour is late, but we want to be delivered, A, from the pressure of having to stay when we know we ought to go. Want to be free to be able to leave a meeting. And we also want to be delivered from the tradition of having to finish at 10 o'clock, Lord. We want to be able to finish at 9, quarter to 11. So, Father, we thank you for this time tonight. We thank you for our brother's ministry. We receive it. We embrace it. And we ask that you will establish the doors of our homes, of our fellowships, that whole households may not be subverted by false teachers, but that we are truly covered in these days. Not smothered, Lord, but covered. Bless the elderships. Bless the husbands. Bless the wives. Bless the teenagers that are emerging into leadership of the young. Bless each and every one. Bless the musicians. Let them be doors. Bless the prophets. Bless the practical workers, Lord, that we each one might take up our place and that in this way you might restore the supernatural element of the church. I know, Lord, we know, Lord, that it's the age of restoration. We're going to see it flooding in. We can't force it. We can't squeeze it out. We've tried, Lord, but you are restoring. The hour is coming, hallelujah, when you're going to manifest your glory in your house. And we're not in it because of that, Lord. We're in it for the eternal blessing and joy of being with you. But we know you're going to manifest that power. So be with us now, we pray in Jesus' name. Consolidate what's been said. Yes. Amen.
Larger than the earth. Half of hell was colored red, and the other half was pitch black. I asked the angel, "Why is this parted red?" And the angel replied, "Do you not know? It is burning sulfur. The other half is darkness. When people sin and end up here, they will be tormented from both sides. There are multitudes of churches on the earth, and many of the churches are filled with many people. However, most of them are not true Christians. They are but church attendants. The true churches will firmly believe in heaven and hell. The lives of many Christians are in chaos because they do not firmly believe in heaven and hell. When one soul enters heaven, 1,000 cursed souls enter hell. The rate of heaven and hell is 1,000 to 1. I am a Presbyterian pastor and a well-known speaker. I have graduated from one of the largest theological schools in Korea, and I never believed any of those heaven and hell stories. But now, I am one who writes such experiences to testify to others. Although you may believe you are a Christian, if you live your life according to the will of demons, you will end up in hell. The first place I saw was a place of burning sulfur. You can't imagine how hot the fires in hell are. No one can bear the intense heat. People in hell say three statements. First, they say, it's too hot and they feel like dying. Second, they say they're thirsty and feel like dying. Thirdly, you'll hear many people asking for water. It is eternal. Many people say that we are free in Christ, and they live their lives as they desire. I asked the angel, those who are here, what have they done? And the angel answered, the first group is unbelievers. So those of us who have not evangelized to our own families must repent. The angel continued, the second group is those who believed in Jesus, but did not repent of their sin. We must repent of our sin and must confess to the Lord. We must not sin. Just giving lip service is not repenting. With a contrite and earnest heart, we must repent. Seeing Christians in hell. I then saw many pastors, elders, and deacons in hell. And I asked the angel, I know them. They had served God faithfully while on the earth. They had died some time ago, and we all thought they had gone to heaven with God. But now I see them all in hell, and they're all crying out that it's so hot. Why are they here? There were so many pastors, elders, deacons, and all other lay believers. The angel answered, Pastor Park, a person can appear to be a true follower of Christ on the outside, but God knows the heart. They did not keep Sundays holy. In fact, they had loved to make money on Sundays. Many of the deacons and elders had criticized the sermons of their pastors. They did not tithe properly. They did not pray. They had not evangelized to people at all. Many of these elders and deacons had harassed their pastors and would come against their authority. They had interfered with the pastor's duties and business. On their deathbed, they had thought they had done a good job, so they did not repent of those things. This is why they were thrown into the fires of hell. I then saw a king and a prince who had first persecuted the Christians in China. This king and prince beheaded many of the first believers in Korea. They were placed in the center, which was the hottest of all. I also saw Hitler, Stalin, and Mao Zedong, and a famous pastor from North Korea named Pastor Kang, and a famous Japanese hero, and many more. Then we arrived at an extremely dark place, too dark to see where to step. And I shouted, angels, angels, it's so dark. I can't see anything. The angels patted my shoulder and said, just wait a little bit. Within a few moments, I was able to see a countless number of naked people. All of them had insects crawling all over their bodies. And not an inch was spared, as their whole bodies were completely covered with insects. Naked people attempted to drive the insects away, gnashing their teeth. And I asked, what did these people do as they lived on the earth? The angel replied, they are those who had criticized and backstabbed each other. They were not careful with what they had said to one another. I saw the demons piercing and stabbing the stomachs of the people with sickles. Their screams were unbearable to me, and I asked my escort, "Angels, what did these people do as they lived on the earth?" And the angel replied, "These people had jobs, houses, and families, but they did not give to God. They did not help the poor, their churches, or other godly purposes. They were very stingy and greedy. Even as they encountered the poor, they ignored them and did not care. They only cared for themselves and their families, were well clothed, fed, and had a comfortable life. This is why their stomachs are pierced, for their bellies were full of greed." It was such a very frightening scene. After witnessing such a scene, when I got back to the earth, I gave all my money and possessions to others. Salvation cannot be earned with money or property. It is by faith. Hell is an unbearably miserable place. It is eternal torment. I also saw people who had their heads hacked off by a very sharp saw. And I asked the angel, "What do these people do to deserve such awful torment?" And the angel replied, "Their brains were given by God to think good and beneficial things. But these people had thoughts of filthy things. They thought of lustful things." Next, I saw people being stabbed and cut into pieces. Oh, the sight was horrible. And I asked, "What about these people? What did they do to be tormented in such a way?" The angel replied, "These were elders and deacons who did not serve their churches. In fact, they did not even want to work or serve. The only things they had loved were to receive and receive from the flock." I saw elders, deacons, and other lay believers tormented by the demons. The demons made a hole in their tongues and placed wires to the tongues of one another. Then the demons would drag the people with the wire. And I asked, "What did they do on earth?" The angel answered, "They had committed four different types of sin. First, they had criticized their pastors. They would speak negative things about their pastors. They were backbiting and ridiculing their pastors. I plead with you, if you've committed such a sin, repent quickly, repent." The angel continued, "Second, they insulted the church with their words."
Chapter 4. Beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits whether they are of God, because many false prophets are gone out into the world. Hereby know ye the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesseth that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is of God. And every spirit that confesseth not that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is not of God. And this is that spirit of Antichrist, whereof ye have heard that it should come. And even now already is it in the world. Ye are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. They are of the world, therefore speak they of the world, and the world heareth them. We are of God. He that knoweth God heareth us. He that is not of God heareth not us. Hereby know we the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God. And everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God. He that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. In this was manifested the love of God toward us, because that God sent his only begotten Son into the world, that we might live through him. Herein is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us, and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, If God so loved us, we ought also to love one another. No man hath seen God at any time. If we love one another, God dwelleth in us, and his love is perfected in us. Hereby know we that we dwell in him, and he in us, because he hath given us of his Spirit. And we have seen and do testify that the Father sent the Son to be the Savior of the world. Whosoever shall confess that Jesus is the Son of God, God dwelleth in him, and he in God. And we have known and believed the love that God hath to us. God is love, and he that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God, and God in him. Herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casteth out fear, because fear hath torment. He that feareth is not made perfect in love. We love him because he first loved us. If a man say, I love God, and hateth his brother, he is a liar. For he that loveth not his brother whom he hath seen, how can he love God whom he hath not seen? And this commandment have we from him, that he who loveth God love his brother also.